Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Living Up the Street by Gary Soto, narrated by Robert Ramirez.
Being mean. We were terrible kids, I think. My brother, sister, and I felt a general meanness begin to surface from our tiny souls while living on Braley Street, which was in the middle of industrial Fresno. Across the street was Coleman Pickles, while on the right of us was a junkyard that dealt in metals, aluminum, iron, sheet metal, and copper stripped from refrigerators. Down the street was Sun-Made Raisin, where a concrete tower rose above the scraggly sycamores that lined Braley Street. Many of our family worked at Sun-Made, grandfather and grandmother, father, three uncles, an aunt, and even a dog, whose job was to accompany my grandfather, a security guard, on patrol. Then there was Challenge Milk, a printing shop, and the 7-Up Company, where we stole sodas. Down the alley was a broom factory and Western Book Distributor, a place where our future stepfather worked at packing books into cardboard boxes, something he would do for 15 years before the company left town for Oregon. This was 1957. My brother Rick was 6, I was 5, and Debra was 4. Although we looked healthy, clean in the morning, and polite as only Mexicans can be polite, we had a streak of orneriness that we imagined to be normal play. That summer, and the summer previous, we played with the Molinas, who lived down the alley from us, right across from the broom factory, and its brutal whack of straw being tied into brooms. There were 8 children on the block that year, ranging from 12 down to 1, so there was much to do. Wrestle, eat raw bacon, jump from the couch, sword fight with rolled-up newspapers, steal from neighbors, kick chickens, throw rocks at passing cars. While we played in the house, Mother Molina just watched us run around, a baby in her arms, crying like a small piece of machinery turning at great speed. Now and then, she would warn us with a smile. "Now, you kids, you're going to hurt yourselves." We ignored her and went on pushing one another from an opened window, yelling wildly when we hit the ground because we imagined that there was a school of sharks ready to snack on our skinny legs. What we learned from the Molinas was how to have fun, and what we taught them was how to fight. It seemed that the Sotos were inherently violent. I remember, for instance, watching my aunts going at one another in my grandmother's backyard while the men looked on with beers in their hands and mumbled to one another, perhaps noting the beauty of a jab or a roundhouse punch. Another time, the police arrived late at night in search of our Uncle Leonard, who had gotten into a fight at a neighborhood bar. Shortly thereafter, I recall driving with my mother to see him at what she said was a soldiers' camp. She had a sack of goods with her, and after speaking softly to a uniformed man, we were permitted to enter. It was lunchtime, and he sat on a felled log laughing with other men. When he saw us coming, he laughed even harder. In turn, I was edged with a meanness, and more often than not, the object of my attacks was Rick. If upset, I chased him with rocks, pans, a hammer, whatever lay around in the yard. Once, when he kicked over a row of beans I had planted in the yard, I chased him down the alley with a bottle until, in range, I hurled it at him. The bottle hit him in the thigh and, to my surprise, showered open with blood. Screaming, his mouth open wide enough to saucer a hat inside, he hobbled home while I stood there, only slightly worried at his wound and the spanking that would follow, shouting that he had better never do that again. And he didn't. I was also hurt by others who were equally as mean, and I am thinking particularly of an Okie kid who yelled that we were dirty Mexicans. Perhaps so, but why bring it up? I looked at my feet and was embarrassed, then mad. With a bottle, I approached him slowly in spite of my brother's warnings that the kid was bigger and older. When I threw the bottle and missed, he swung his stick and my nose exploded blood for several feet. Frightened, though not crying, I ran home with Rick and Debra chasing me and dabbed at my face and t-shirt, poked mercurochrome at the tear that bubbled, and then lay on the couch, swallowing blood as I slowly grew faint and sleepy. Rick and Debra looked at me for a while, then got up to go outside to play. Rick and I and the Molinas all enjoyed looking for trouble and often went to extremes to try to get into fights. One day we found ourselves staring at some new kids on the street, three of them about our age, and when they looked over their picket fence to see who we were, I thought one of them had sneered at us, so I called him a name. They called back at us, and that provocation was enough to send Rick to beat on one of them. Rick entered their yard and was punched in the ear, then in the back when he tried to hunch over to protect himself. Furious as a bee, I ran to fight the kid who had humbled Rick, but was punched in the stomach, which knocked the breath out of me so I couldn't tell anyone how much it had hurt. The Molinas grew scared and ran home, while Rick and I, slightly roughed up but sure that we had the guts to give them a good working over, walked slowly home, trying to figure out how to do it. A small flame lit my brain, and I suggested that we stuff a couple of cats into potato sacks and beat the kids with them. An even smaller light flared in my brother's brain. "Yeah, that'll get them," he said, happy that we were going to get even. We called to our cat, Boots, and found another unfortunate cat that was strolling nonchalantly down our alley in search of prime garbage. I called to it, and it came, purring. I carried it back to our yard, where Rick had already stuffed Boots into a sack, which was bumping about on the ground. Seeing this, the cat stiffened in my arms, and I had trouble working the cat into the sack, for it had spread its feet and opened its claws. But once inside, the cat grew calm, resigning itself to fate, and meowed only once or twice. For good measure, I threw a bottle into my sack, and the two of us, or to be fair, the four of us, went down the alley in search of the new kids. We looked for them, even calling their names at their back porch, but they failed to show themselves. Rick and I believed that they were scared, so in a way, we were victors. Being mean, we kicked over their garbage cans and ran home, where we fought one another with the sacks, the cats all along whining and screaming to get out. Perhaps the most enjoyable summer day was when Rick, Debra, and I decided to burn down our house. Earlier in the summer, we had watched a television program on fire prevention at our grandmother's house, only three houses down from us on Sarah Street. The three of us sat transfixed in front of the gray light of the family's first TV. We sat on the couch with a bowl of grapes, and when the program ended, the bowl was still in Rick's lap, untouched. TV was that powerful. Just after that program, Rick and I set fire to our first shoebox, in which we imagined were many people scurrying to get out. We hovered over the fire, and our eyes grew wild. Later, we got very good at burning shoeboxes. We crayoned windows, cut doors on the sides, and dropped ants into the boxes, imagining they were people wanting very badly to live. Once the fire got going, I wailed like a siren, and Rick flicked water from a coffee can at the building, leaping with flames. More often than not, it burned to ash, and the ants shriveled to nothing, though a few would limp away, wiser by vision of death. But we grew bored with the shoeboxes. We wanted something more exciting and daring, so Rick suggested that we brighten our lives with a house fire. "Yeah," Debra and I cried, leaping into the air, and proceeded to toss crumpled newspapers behind the doors, under the table, and in the middle of the living room. Rick struck a match, and we stood back laughing as the flames jumped wildly about and the newspaper collapsed into ash that floated to the ceiling. Once the fire got started, We dragged in the garden hose and sprayed the house, the three of us laughing for the love of good times. We were in a frenzy to build fires and put them out with the hose. I looked at Rick, and his eyes were wide with pleasure, his crazed laughter like the mad scientists of the movies we would see in the coming years. Debra was jumping up and down on the couch, a toy baby in her arms, and she was smiling her tiny teeth at the fire. I ran outside, flapping my arms, because I wanted to also burn the chinaberry that stood near our bedroom window. Just as I was ready to set a match to a bald newspaper I intended to hurl into the branches, our grandmother came walking slowly down the alley to check on us. It was her responsibility to watch us during the day, because our father was working at Sun-Made Raisin, and our mother was peeling potatoes at Ready Spud. Grandma stopped at the gate and stared at me, as if she knew what we were up to, and I stared back so I could make a quick break if she should lunge at me. Finally, she asked, "How are you, honey?" I stared at my dirty legs, then up to her. "Okay, I'm just playing." With the bald newspaper in my hand, I pointed to the house and told her that Rick and Debra were inside coloring. Hearing this, she said to behave myself, gave me a piece of gum, and returned to her house. When I went back inside, Rick and Debra were playing war with cherry tomatoes. Debra was behind the table on which the telephone rested, while Rick crouched behind a chair, making the sounds of bombs falling. "Rick," I called, because I wanted to tell him that Grandma had come to see how we were doing, but he threw a tomato and it splashed my t-shirt like a bullet wound. I feigned being shot and fell to the floor. He rolled from behind the chair to hide behind a door. "Are you dead?" he asked. I lifted my head and responded, "Only a little bit." Laughing, we hurled tomatoes at one another, and some of them hit their mark, an ear, a shoulder, a grinning face, while others skidded across the floor or became pasted to the wall. "You Jap!" Debra screamed as she cocked her hand to throw, to which I screamed, "You damn German!" We fought, laughing, until the tomatoes were gone. Breathing hard, we looked at the mess we had created, and then at each other, slightly concerned at what it might mean. Rick and I tried to clean up with a broom, while Debra lay exhausted on the couch, thumb in her mouth and making a smacking sound. I can't recall falling asleep, but that's what happened, because I awoke to Rick crying in the kitchen. Our mother had come home to an ash-darkened living room, a puddled kitchen, and tomato-stained walls. She yelled and spanked Rick, after which she dragged him to the stove where she heated a fork over a burner and threatened to burn his wrists. "Now are you going to play with fire?" she screamed. I peeked into the kitchen, and her mouth was puckered into a dried fruit as Rick cried that she was hurting him, that he was sorry, that he would never do it again. Tears leaped from his face as he tried to wiggle free. She threw the fork into the sink, then let him go. She turned to me and yelled, "And you too, Chango!" She started after me, but I ran out the front door into the alley where I hid behind a stack of boards. I stayed there until my breathing calmed and my fear disappeared like an ash picked up by the wind. I got up, and knowing that I couldn't return home immediately, I went to the Molinas. Just as I turned into their yard, I caught sight of two of them climbing, hand over hand, on the telephone wires that stretched from above the back porch to the pole itself. A few of the younger Molinas looked on from an opened window, readying for their turn as the radio blared behind them. I threw a rock at the two hanging from the wires, and they laughed that I missed. The other kids laughed. Their mother, with a baby in her arms, came out to the back porch, laughed, and told us to behave ourselves. Father. My father was showing me how to water. Earlier in the day, he and a friend had leveled the backyard with a roller, then with a 2x4 they dragged on a rope to fill in the depressed areas. after which they watered the ground and combed it slowly with a steel rake. They were preparing the ground for a new lawn. They worked shirtless in the late summer heat and talked only so often, stopping now and then to point and say things I didn't understand. How fruit trees would do better near the alley, and how the vegetable garden would do well on the east side of the house. "Put your thumb like this," he said. Standing over me, he took the hose and placed his thumb over the opening so that the water streamed out hissing and showed silver in that dusk. I tried it, and the water hissed and went silver as I pointed the hose to a square patch of dirt that I soaked but was careful not to puddle. Father returned to sit down with an iced tea. His knees were water-stained and his chest was flecked with mud. Mom sat next to him, garden gloves resting on her lap. She was wearing checkered shorts and her hair was tied up in a bandana. He patted his lap, and she jumped into it girlishly, arms around his neck. They raised their heads to watch me, or look through me, as if something were on the other side of me, and talked about our new house, the neighbors, trees they would plant, the playground down the block. They were tired from the day's work, but were happy. When Father pinched her legs, as if to imply they were fat, she punched him gently and played with his hair. The water streamed, nickel-colored, as I slowly worked from one end to the next. When I raised my face to Father's to ask if I could stop, he pointed to an area that I had missed. Although it was summer, I was cold from the water, and my thumb hurt from pressing the hose, trigger-like, to reach the far places. But I wanted to please him, to work hard as he had, so I watered the patch until he told me to stop. I turned off the water, coiled the hose as best I could, and sat with them as they talked about the house and stared at where I had been standing. The next day, Father was hurt at work, a neck injury. 2 days later, he was dead. I remember the hour, 2 in the afternoon. An uncle slammed open the back door at Grandma's, and the three of us, Cousin Isaac, Debbie and I, who were playing in the yard, grew stiff because we thought we were in trouble for doing something wrong. He looked at us, face lined with worry and shouting to hurry to the car. At the hospital, I recall Mother holding her hand over her eyes as if she was looking into a light. She was leaning into someone's shoulder and was being led away from the room in which Father lay. I remember looking up but saying nothing, though I sensed what had happened, that Father was dead. I didn't feel sorrow, nor did I cry, but I felt conspicuous because relatives were pressing me against their legs or holding my hand or touching my head tenderly. I stood among them, some of whom were crying while others had their heads bowed and mouths moving. The three of us were led away down the hall to a cafeteria, where an uncle bought us candies that we ate standing up and looking around, after which we left the hospital and walked into a harsh afternoon light. We got into a blue car I had never seen before. At the funeral, there was crying. I knelt with my brother and sister, hands folded and trying to be patient, though I was itchy from the tiny coat whose shoulders worked into my armpits and from the heat of a stuffy car on our long and slow drive from the church in town. Prayers were said, and a eulogy was given by a man we didn't know. We were asked to view the casket, with our mother and the three of us to lead the procession. An uncle helped my mother while we walked shyly to view our father for the last time. When I stood at the casket, I was surprised to see him, eyes closed and moist-looking, and wearing a cap the color of skin. Years later, I would realize that it hid the wound from which he had died. I looked quickly and returned to my seat, head bowed because my relatives were watching me and I felt scared. We buried our father. Later that day at the house, Grandma could not stop shaking from her nerves, so a doctor was called. I was in the room when he opened his bag, and shiny things gleamed from inside. Scared, I left the room and sat in the living room with my sister, who had a donut in her hand, with one bite gone. An aunt whose face was twisted from crying looked at me, and feeling embarrassed, I lowered my head to play with my fingers. A week later, relatives came to help build the fence Father had planned for the new house. A week after that, Rick, Debra, and I were playing in an unfurnished bedroom with a can of marbles Mother had given us. Behind the closed door, we rolled the marbles so that they banged against the baseboard and jumped into the air. We separated, each to a corner, where we swept them viciously with our arms, the clatter of the marbles hitting the walls so loud I couldn't hear the things in my heart. One, two, three. When I was 7 years old, I spent most of the summer at Romaine Playground, a brown stick among other brown kids. The playground was less than a block from where we lived, on a street of retired couples, Oki families, and two or three Mexican families. Just before leaving for work, our mother told us, my brother Rick, sister Debra, and me, not to leave the house until after 1 p.m, at which time I skipped off to the playground, barefoot and smiling my teeth that were uneven and without direction. By that hour, the day was yellow with 100-degree heat, the sun blaring high over the houses. I walked the asphalt street with little or no pain toward a mirage of water that disappeared as I approached it. At the playground, I asked for checkers at the game room, unfolded the board under the elm that was cut with initials, and, if he was there, I played with Ronnie, an Oki kid who was so poor that he had nothing to wear but a bathing suit. All summer he showed up in his trunks, brown as the rest of us Mexicans, and seemed to enjoy himself playing checkers, Candyland, and Sorry. Once, when I brought him an unwrapped jelly sandwich in my hand, the shapes of my fingers pressed into the bread, he took it and didn't look into my eyes. He ate very slowly, deliberating over each move. When he beat me and had polished off his sandwich, he turned away without a word and ran off to play with someone else. If Ronnie wasn't there and no one else challenged me, I just sat under the tree stacking checkers until they toppled over, and I started again to raise that crooked spine of checkers a foot high. If there were only little kids, 4 or 5-year-olds who could count to 10, I played Candyland, a simple game of gumdrops and sugar canes down a road to an ice cream sandwich. I remember playing with Rosie, a 5-year-old whose brother Raymond got his leg broken when he was hit by a car. I wasn't around that day, but I recall racing a friend to where it had happened to look at the dried blood on the curb. My friend and I touched the stain. I scratched at it so that a few flakes got under my nails, and no matter how I picked and sucked at them, they wouldn't come out. We both ran home very frightened. Rosie sat across the picnic-like table from me, her stringy hair spiked with a few flowers, and called me Blackie when it was my turn to spin the wheel and move down the Candyland Road. I didn't hit her because she had 6 brothers, 5 of them bigger than me. To smack her would have meant terror that would last for years. But the truth was that she liked me, for she offered me sunflower seeds from her sweaty palms and let me spit the shells at her. "Spin the wheel, Blackie," she said with a mouthful of her seeds and sniffling from a perennial cold, a bubble of snot coming and going. "Okay, tetherball head," I countered. Both of us laughed at each other's cleverness while we traded off spitting shells at one another, a few pasting themselves to our foreheads. One Saturday morning, a well-dressed man let his daughter try the slide. Rosie ran over to join the little girl, who was wearing a dress, her hair tied into a neat ponytail. Her shoes were glossy black, and she wore socks with red trim. Rosie squealed at the little girl, and the girl squealed back, and they both ran off to play while the father sat with his newspaper on the bench. I went and sat on the same bench, shyly picking at the brittle green paint, but not looking up at the man at first. When my eyes did lift, slowly, like balloons let go, I took it all in. His polished shoes, creased pants, the shirt, and his watch that glinted as he turned the page of his newspaper. I had seen fathers like him before, on the Donna Reed Show or Father Knows Best, and I was pleased that he was here, at our playground, because I felt that we were being trusted, that nearby, just beyond our block, the rich people lived and were welcoming. He looked up from the newspaper at me and forced a quick smile that relaxed back into a line as he returned to his paper. Happily, I jumped from the bench and rushed to play with Rosie and the little girl, hoping to catch the man's eye as I swung twice as high as the girls and parachuted with great abandon to land like a frog. He looked up to smile, but dropped his eyes back to the newspaper as he recrossed his legs. But then it happened. The little girl fell from the swing while Rosie was pushing her. Startled by her sudden crying, the man's eyes locked on the scene of Rosie hovering over his daughter, crying on the ground. He jumped up, yelling, "You filthy Mexican!" He picked up his daughter, who had stopped crying, and then, turning to Rosie, who was saying that she hadn't done anything, he shoved her hard against the chain-link fence so that her sunflower seeds flew in every direction. She got up, bent over, her breath knocked out, mouth open wide as a cup, and a string of saliva lengthening to the ground. Three of her brothers were playing Chinese checkers under the tree, and when they saw what had happened, they ran to fight the man with handfuls of redwood chips that they had scooped up from the play area. Like the rest of us, the brothers, who ranged from 8 to 14, wore t-shirts and cutoffs, but with no shoes, sons of the very poor. But unlike the rest of us, they were fierce brawlers who would go at it even with older kids as they flew up like chickens against those who got them mad. Yelling, "You nigger people!" his raised arm blocking the puffs of redwood chips, the man was backed into the merry-go-round while his daughter, some distance away, clung to the chain-link fence. He charged one brother and pushed him to the ground, only to feel a handful of redwood chips against his face. Coughing, he grabbed another brother and threw him to the ground, while still another threw a softball at his back. In pain, the man turned around and chased the brother, but was stopped by the coach who had come running from the baseball game on the other side of the playground. "Don't touch him," the coach warned the man, who was shouting whatever wild insults came to his mind. The coach tried to coax him to calm down, but the man, whose eyes were glassy, raved rabidly as his arms flailed about. I had been watching from upside down on the bars, but got down to help Rosie gather her seeds. She was on her knees, face streaked and nose running. I pinched up three seeds from the ground before I turned to stand by the brothers, who were still taunting the man with Coke bottles they had pulled from the garbage. Suddenly, the man broke down, and as loudly as he had screamed names, he screamed that he was sorry, that he didn't know what he was doing. He gathered his daughter in his arms, repeated again and again that he was sorry. The coach ushered him to the gate, while the brothers, two of them crying, yelled that they were going to get him. "You are no one, mister. You think you can do this to us because we're little," one said, with his Coke bottle still cocked and ready. I wanted to run for them as they left for their car, to explain that it was a mistake, that we also fell from the swings and the bars and slide and got hurt. I wanted to show the man my chin that broke open on the merry-go-round, the half-moon of pink scar. But they hurried away, sweaty from the morning sun, the man's pants and shirt stained with dirt, and the little girl's limp dress smudged from her fall, and in some ways, looking like us. I returned to Rosie, who was still collecting her seeds, and feeling bad but not knowing what to do, I got to my knees and asked if she wanted to play. I touched her hair, then her small shoulders, and called her name. She looked up at me, her face still wet from crying, and said, "Go away, Blackie." That summer, my eyes became infected. My brother and I had a contest to see how long we could stare into the table fan without looking away. I was there for an hour, my head propped up in my hands, pretending all along I was in a biplane and the earth far below was World War I France. That summer, we watched Dialing for Dollars, a morning program that featured many war movies. Together, we sat in a rocker-turned-fighter plane and machine-gunned everyone to death, both the good and the bad. An hour in front of the fan, and the next morning, I woke with my eyes caked with mucus and unable to open them. I screamed to my mother, who was in the kitchen stirring oatmeal, and when she came to the bedroom, she screamed louder than me and fainted, dropping to the floor like a bundle of laundry. My brother rushed into the room with my sister following behind him, and both of them screamed when they saw Mom moaning on the ground. Looking up, they screamed as my hands searched the air and flew to the living room. My mother woke with an "Ay, Dios!" bundled me in her arms, and carried me to the bathroom, where she rinsed a hot washcloth and rubbed it across my eyes until the mucus softened and my lids fluttered open. She screamed again, because my eyes were not red, but milky. She called the doctor, who suggested an eye specialist, and that afternoon she took me to see the specialist with my eyes covered by a bandana. We were seen immediately. The nurse ushered us into a dimmed examining room where we were met by a doctor who lifted me into a chair whose motor whined until I was tilted far back. He pointed a small chrome flashlight at each eye, and with a Q-tip, he tapped mucus from the corners of my eyes. With the lights back on, he squeezed eye drops between my spread lids, gave my mother instructions, and said it was important that I wear special sunglasses for the next 3 days. He fitted me with plastic, smoke-colored glasses with paper earpieces. "How's that, young man?" he said, trying to be cheerful. "You'll be just fine in a couple of days." He patted my knee and gave me a candy. While Mother paid the receptionist, I looked around the room, from the ceiling to the pictures of ships in a rough sea. It was smoky through the glasses. When we left the air-conditioned office, the heat of the afternoon overwhelmed me, and I wanted to take off the glasses to wipe my nose of sweat. But Mother said that the light would make me go blind. We drove home in silence, past the smoky church and the smoky furniture store. I looked at my mother, and she was smoky. Our block was smoky as we turned into it. My brother and sister, who greeted me with laughter, were darker than we'd left them. My mother scolded them and told them to water the lawn while we went inside, where I was given a bowl of ice cream. I took this treat to the front window and looked out on a knot of smoky neighbor kids who were staring in silence. One of them asked if I was blind. "No, Frosty," I called through the screened window. "I can still see your mocos." That night, I was pampered by Mother. Rick and Debra grew envious because I was served more ice cream, more this and that, and was allowed to stay up until 9:30 to watch Dobie Gillis in my smoky sunglasses. I could hear my brother in bed trying to talk to me. "I'm going to get you, Gary," Rick said. I laughed especially loud at each funny scene, and when the program ended, I said, "Boy, that was real good." When I was sent to bed, I took off my sunglasses carefully and fogged them with my breath, rubbing them clean with my t-shirt. I placed them on the bureau and climbed into my bunk bed while Rick muttered threats because he felt that I was being spoiled.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.